What up, gangsters? Hello, hello. Happy Friday, everybody. Let me say hi to the chat. Hi, Meatball. Hi, Tawny C. Hi, Forensics. Hi, Brad Conley. Hi, R. Taylor. Hi, Chris Graves. I'm so glad you made it. Hi, Desert Rain. Hi, Dave Steege. And I said hi, Forensics. Hi, Old Car. Hi, France. Hi, Mae Brussel. And hi, Pete Thomas. And who else am I missing? Hi, Aspa60. Hi, Leash. And let me see. Hello to our cross-referencing queen, Dana. Thank you so much. And thank you so much for dropping in. That's okay. All right, guys. And nice pile drive to the face. That's an awesome, that's an awesome username. Welcome. Thank you guys so much for being here. So we have like, this is just like chill. We're just chilling tonight. We're going to have a little fun. I obviously have a lot to show you guys, especially if you've been on my Twitter. Hi, Don Lambert. Yeah, I have a ton to show you guys because, it's all just getting really weird, but I love it and I'm here for it. It's freaking great. So let's go ahead and run the intro and then we will get started. I don't even know which one I want to use. Yes, I do. All right, see you guys soon.
What is the process?
Must we drag all that up again?
Is it old to the death? Better hold your breath. In the cell, I prevail. Freddy sent from hell. Ring the bell when you're finished. I'm a grown man and winning. Sacrificing to the demons. No, I love it when you screaming. Commit to your thoughts. Do it now what you lost in the darkness. You will never wake up so conscious, anxious. Why are you so scared of feeling pain, bitch? Devil in your soul. Cut it now and then you'll go. Walk on the dark path. Kill and you feel that. Never in your life you gotta rush from the kickback. Matt Black, Glock 10, knock on the neck, man. Hear the whispering, devil taking over them. Listen to my words of Freddy, tell it do the devil's work. Listen to my words of Freddy, tell it do the devil's work. All red, homie, got the blood up in your hair. Sign your soul to the devil, now you asking is it fair? Listen to my words of Freddy, tell it do the devil's work. Listen to my words of Freddy, tell it do the devil's work. All red, homie, got the blood up in your hair. Sign your soul to the devil, now you asking is it fair?
Listen to my words of Freddy, tell it do the devil's work. Listen to my words of Freddy, tell it do the devil's work. Listen to my words of Freddy, tell it do the devil's work. Listen to my words of Freddy, tell it do the devil's work. Listen to my words of Freddy, tell it do the devil's work.
Don't forget, we are literally out here fighting demons, y'all. Hey, Soil Lodge. Thank you so much for being here, Robert Gilman. Hell yeah, run that Freddy Dread. That's what's up. All right. So, like I said, tonight is just mostly chill, even though I definitely have stuff to show you guys. And hello, Gary Bellwood. Hello. Thank you so much for being here. So, I don't even know where to start. For my people that are on Twitter, sorry, some of this is definitely going to be a repetition of stuff that you have seen, but you know, it is what it is. I guess let's go ahead and I want to show you guys because I don't think that I pulled it up last time because we did the Children of God, right? So I need to show you guys some of the Best Friends magazine. I'm not gonna like pull up the magazine itself because that would just, it would get too laggy. It would be very time consuming. I will add my archive of the magazine though in the description. Afterwards, I will add it because I did archive it from the university in Utah that has it. But let me show you guys just a couple of them because, like I said, of course, these people are all about propaganda, right? So, of course, they have to have a magazine. You know what I mean? Hi, Auntie Green. Hi, Annie Kurtz. Hey, Mr. Crow. Hi, Eric G. Hello. And okay, I think I'm caught up. All right, so let's go ahead and take a peek. And then I'm going to show you guys who some of these people are. Yeah, because they are. They're the process. They're the exact same people doing the exact same thing. Okay, so this is Charity Benedicte, aka Mother Rhea, Ophelia, aka Isabel Rennie, aka Isabel Nasser, the advocate for Satan. And right here, so this, I'm gonna screw it up if I zoom in. No, I'm not. There we go. Her, this is Timothy Wiley's wife, former wife. That's his old lady. That's Mother Maya. That's crazy to me, but I'm going to show you guys the picture of them like next to each other. You know what I mean? But let's go to the next one. So here we are. There is Faith Maloney, aka Geraldine Maloney, aka Geraldine Brown, aka Mother Lilith Hather Minerva. So that's her. And then right here, so this is Judah Batista, I believe. Yeah, right there, Judah. So this is the Batista's kid. Which is interesting, right? Because obviously there's a lot of nepotism. That's a big complaint with a lot of the animal rights activists, and understandably so, because these people are making hand over fist. Hello, a fire pixie. Hello, hello. All right, now let me go to the next one, unless this thing is going to freeze on me. Let's see. Okay. This one just really bothered me. This one on the left with the cat really bothered me. I don't know why. I just feel like it's very like dystopian hellscape, you know, a cat with one ear. No kill animal shelters, the wave of the future. According to them, it's going to be. And then over here, this little donkey just I thought that he was very cute and you know, just says, God bless you. And I'm like, he's a sad donkey. He reminds me of Eeyore. I don't know why, for some reason, he reminds me of Eeyore. That's always gonna remind me of Eeyore. Now I'm going to, I don't know if it's gonna pull up like perfect, but I'm gonna show you guys because I did put up on my Twitter a side by side, but that way you guys can see who these people are, because they also have programs with mentally handicapped children. Surprise! Is anyone surprised? Because that's what they were doing at Willowbrook. Jandon, thank you so much. Please don't do that. And thank you. I appreciate it. My day has been okay. Oh, you made a post for me on Twitter. Well, I will go and I will find it when I'm done. I promise. Remind me, but not with a super chat, please. That's not appropriate. Thank you. Now, let me get this up. Okay, so right here. Ready? Ah, that's her. That's her. Look at her. The same dead eyes. She's man, I'm gonna have to pull up her slide because she's like a super wealthy heir, and I did a deep dive on her previously. And then right here, that's her. Obviously, she looks much more similar than in the original process publication, where she's just Isabel Rennie, advocate for Lucifer. Duh. And then over here, this isn't gonna work, I don't think. Oh yeah, so well, it cut off. Dang it. Anyways, heel, Rover heel, and then there's their Willowbrook stuff. What are you doing Saturday? You know, I hate it. I hate it. This stuff makes me so mad. I'm sorry. It makes me very angry. Now, I thought I had a map in here that I wanted to show you guys, but maybe I didn't save it. That's okay. All right, whatever. We're taking it easy tonight. I'm not on a schedule. I'm not getting stressed out about anything. We're chilling, okay? Because it's been a day. If you guys have been on Twitter, really for the past like 2 days, it's been a day. Let's go ahead and just pull up the process PowerPoint right now because I forgot that I had found some interesting stuff about Canada. Thank you, Chanton. Stop it. I forgot that I had found some interesting stuff about Canada in particular, and I needed to show you guys, but we got tied up with the children of God. Whatever. It is what it is. And then obviously, I'm going to show you guys where I found them in particular with the children of God, but I want to show you Charity Benedicte really quick. That way, I'm not a dirty liar. And that way, you guys can see best friends, familiars. Yeah. And again, for the people on my Twitter, I'm sorry, this is absolutely repetition. However, here is her obituary that you can only find on the Best Friends website. It does not exist in the public records. And there she is, Mother Ophelia, Mother Rhea, Lucifer's advocate, Isabel Rennie, Isabel Ann Nasser. That's her. That is her. And I don't know, right here. Yeah. So she was exceptionally empathic and would sometimes surprise me and her co-founders with an off-the-cuff psychic reading. She was usually spot on. Charity even extended her psychic gifts to the best friend's lint roller party. Imagine that. Yeah? Imagine that. And she... I'm working with Leash right now to try and figure out what the hell is going on in Texas, because she's the only process member that got naturalized in Texas. So I think that that's really interesting because she's there from day one. She's a major OG in the church. I mean, obviously she's passed away now. So for the people that are wanting to make the argument about legality in a court of law, obviously that's not going to happen with her. And I guess that I should probably go ahead. Well, let me be petty really quick before I address some of the audacious claims that have been made as of late. So, as you guys know, lately there has been a disinformation campaign that the process wasn't in New York, that they disbanded in 1974, blah, 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 blah. Well, I was going back through some of the naturalization papers and I missed something. I missed Jonathan DePeyer, aka Gabriel DePeyer. Anyways, I'm going to show you. I can't remember all of his names right now, but I missed his initial filing and it lists Pound Ridge, right? So we obviously need to see this because the date is very interesting because this absolutely puts them there later. And this is a document from the Department of Justice. Okay. So right here, this is from September 22nd, 1980. Jonathan DePeyer, and there's Gretchen Lawrence. What's her address? Pound Ridge in 1980. Yeah? Hi, Morgana. Hello, hello. So there they are. And apparently they met in France, which is very interesting to me. And it's in November 1969, which also makes sense because we all went through the court records and we know that they were running away from what happened at Cielo Drive specifically. Now, let me go ahead and just address this stupid stuff with Manny, okay? Because, like, I'm not dragging it out all night. So Manny has now changed the goalpost. He's moved the goalpost, as he tends to do. And Manny is now making the absolutely ridiculous argument, and he's making it in two ways, that if you continue to believe anything out of the ultimate evil in regards to the cult theory, and that David Berkowitz did not act alone, that you are supporting a person who got most of their information, not all, even though he's playing that word game too, most of their information about the cult from a convicted child rapist. Okay. And so I called Manny out on it because I said, you are painting me as a rape sympathizer. First off, you don't know what I've been through. So I would really tighten up and maybe watch your mouth about that. Okay. Because that's a really bold assumption and you're being an asshole. But secondly, that's not how this works because Manny's playing this stupid little game about how it's just one person and it's this person who committed this specific crime who's stating that the cult was involved. And that's not true. That's not true at all. And I think that it's a really ridiculous claim to make. And again, he just keeps changing the goalpost and I'm over it. It's very, very nasty. It's very nasty because, again, Manny, you don't know what I've gone through in my life. So for you to paint me as a rape sympathizer, you're a fucking scumbag. Excuse my language, but you're a fucking scumbag. And I'm done taking you seriously because you just want people to like bend the knee and agree with you because you know more than everybody. And I get called stupid and, you know, that like I'm years behind because nobody believes Brother John Paul. Nobody believes so-and-so. I said, okay, all right. Well, let's remember that Wheat threatened to sue me, right? When I brought up Michael Samuel Carr, she threatened to sue me. And then she went silent. I haven't been refuted. And nobody else did the genealogical work for me. That's not genealogy. That's me looking through papers. That's me looking through papers and matching dates and going, huh. Well, that makes sense with the Scientology, right? Because otherwise, that would have put a very young Michael Vail Carr III in Los Angeles. But man, Wheat got so uncomfortable about that, didn't she? Real litigation happy. You guys don't realize that that just makes me feel like I'm on the right track. Yeah? And I haven't been refuted. So it's been how many decades? If Wheat would like to produce her father's birth certificate, we could quash the whole argument and everybody could move on. It would be that simple. But she hasn't, and I don't expect her to, because I don't expect integrity from her. And again, this is an individual that has been running around calling Wheat and her family the heroes of Son of Sam, which is literally the most ridiculous thing that I've ever heard in my life. It's the most ridiculous thing that I've ever heard. But like I said, Manny painting this whole thing is like that I'm a rape sympathizer, a child rape sympathizer. It's really disgusting. And I'm done. I'm officially done with you. We're done with you. You're not a serious person. And you are on a disinformation campaign. And you are trying to push a narrative because you're trying to write a book. You've said it yourself. Okay. So good luck. Good luck with your book. I wish you the best of luck. Because it's a joke. I don't take you seriously anymore. You're not a serious person. Sorry you wasted all that time not looking into these things. Now, let me show you guys specifically the main one that I found for the Children of God, where I have them together. And that was how I put it with the magazine specifically. And I also have them like talking about Manson in Chicago. So, I mean, it's really neither here nor there, but I just want you guys to see how the newspaper was painting it and how I was able to Virginia found that magazine. We already went through the magazine. We don't got to go through it again, but I want to show you guys because it is interesting how they just move through all of their little PR games. Yeah. Okay. So don't skip over. I knew I was going to do it. There we go. Okay. So right here, the Jesus people. And that's the process. See? Right there. The process in Deming, on Deming Place. So it says the Sister Flavia is sitting under that cross. I don't believe that because she's blonde. You know what I mean? So I don't think that that is Sister Flavia. But I mean, I could be wrong. Who knows? These are old pictures. And then right here, turn on to Jesus and guess who's coming again. That makes me very uncomfortable knowing the Children of God. However, that was how we put that together. And then right here, this is them crying about not being involved with Manson, even though the court records absolutely proved that that was not the case. That was not the case. And we also, I've already shown you guys out of Robert de Grimston's own mouth, that Manson was a processian. You know what I mean? Let me see. Manny called you. No. He said that I sympathize with them because I don't agree with the lone nut narrative, right? Because I'm not familiar with all of the nuances of this case. Quite frankly, I don't really want to be. Not right now. There's too many things to figure out. You know what I'm saying? In my opinion, there's way too many things to figure out because Leash was kind enough to send me, and I don't know the name of the radio station, but it's this old radio station where it was when Mae Brussel was alive. And I guess The Ultimate Evil had just come out not that long ago. And they're like talking about it and they're like so excited and serious. And I'm like, hell yeah. And they're talking about the Presidio investigation with Michael Aquino. Like, this is an old radio station. It's awesome. But it's on YouTube. You know what I mean? But she had sent me an episode to listen to about Lilith Aquino specifically. But they had mentioned in one of the later episodes about one of the DAs. I think it was like a DA from Bronx, and how he was the person that basically put the kibosh on the whole cult investigation. So I decided to just like kind of dig around. And I have that man inside of Phoenix House. So imagine that. Right? I'm glad that I don't know all of the little nuances and all of the forensics of the case and that I'm trying to step back and look at the bigger picture. You know what I mean? Because I think that that's what it needs, but I can't do it alone. You guys are helping me out because you guys are incredibly intelligent. Oh, Mae Russell died in 1988. Then this literally has to be like right around the time, because this is when they're talking about the Presidio daycare abuse case. And they're giving her credit for finding these papers where they're talking about Michael Aquino. And that's, I found some really crazy stuff about Lillian, but we're not going to talk about that yet. But I am going to show you guys. For the people that are on Twitter, you guys already know. And again, I'm sorry. You're going to be seeing things twice. It is what it is. Now, for my New Orleans people, which if you've seen Sympathy for the Devil, it is what it is. I do want to show you guys because I'm going to pull up the newspaper articles that I have from there. I hate that this is all off to the side. Let me see if I can move it. However, I went through on Pinterest. I think it was Pinterest. They had an account for Sympathy for the Devil. So I just grabbed some screenshots because I was able to identify this guy. And I'm going back through Timothy Wiley's other writings to try and figure out exactly what this dude's story is, because he's not telling the truth. However, this is Brother Marcellus. Ah, dang it. I knew I was going to do it. Okay. So there he is. So that's Brother Marcellus. So this is William Dwyer. So Timothy Wiley paints the story as William Dwyer's mother was running this bar and the mom was recruiting. It was called the Seven Seas Lounge. The mom was recruiting. She was sending people to the process to be recruited. But that's who he is in the documentary. Emmett Dwyer, formerly Brother Mark. So I'm going to show you guys the New Orleans papers, though, because that was a separate subscription that I had to get. It's kind of a pain in the butt, but whatever. I did find some interesting things, and I don't think that I've shown you guys anything that's in that one. Now, there was one. Okay, I don't think that I showed you guys this. They are in Atlanta in 1972, and Forensics had shown me this Toronto article previously. We're having a tough time. I'm letting you guys know right now. I'm having a real tough time tracking down anything really concrete outside of the newspapers in Canada specifically, and that sucks. Because, you know, Morgana has asked, and I think now that we're circling back, there's something going on because there's no records, there's no property records. And Toronto was where they were really heavily recruiting when they left California. So I think that it's really weird that there's not records there for them. Like, I just have like the Foundation Faith of the Millennium and that's it. And they disappear. There's nothing after that. And I don't believe that they fully left Canada. So that doesn't really make sense to me. But let me pull this one up so I can show you guys. They are in Atlanta as early as 1972. And then obviously, you know, we know that they go straight to Canada. Because obviously they had controversy in Canada, right? But I think that there's also some crimes that were going on as well. So right here, this is the Atlanta Constitution. Don't you screw up. Thank you. Okay, so. Says six visit here and Sister Meredith, which still trying to figure out if this is the phase of various church names, quite frankly, but they are proselytizing and said that they are not part of the Jesus freak movement. Mm-mm. So I think that that investigation that was going on with the Children of God in New York, I think that they probably were trying to distance themselves in the public eye. And they also are in Milwaukee, which I think is very interesting. I need to find them in, dang it, Forensics. What was it? Was it Kentucky? Was it Kentucky? I think it was Kentucky. And then over here, this was one that Forensics had sent me previously. I told you guys I like to find the original articles in the archives myself, just that way I know what I have. Whatever, they're claiming their healing powers. But wait, this is in 1973. This is before the quote-unquote schism, right? Okay. Because the schism's not real. Because it's not real. Because this is the crap that they're talking about when they do the schism and then they're talking about necromancy and stuff. And I'm sorry, but like, I got to drive the point home. I know every once in a while I have new people that come on, and I know that I probably sound like a broken record, but it's like, these things need to be reinforced. And I'm not trying to talk to you guys like your kids. It's just, it's really important to me that the truth is laid out factually about this stuff, because it matters. At the end of the day, it matters, in my opinion. Let's go ahead and look at the Aquinos. Let's just get it out of the way, because I literally like don't have a schedule. I don't have a plan for this. I'm free balling it emotionally and psychologically today. So I told you guys, Leash sent me the radio thing. It was talking about Lilith being in a coven in New York. And I said, what? So are you serious? That's crazy. So I decided to go ahead and look it up. Wouldn't you know it? So the coven was called the Lilith Grove, and it was a part of the Church of Satan. This was what she was running specifically in New Jersey. Now, they weren't mistaken when they said New York, because it did cover the metropolitan area. No, we're not going to sit here and read through all of this, but I do want you guys to see it, because we are officially now able to tie, and it is a tie. So for the people, and I'm particularly addressing Leah Remini's honeypot, who keeps bringing up remote viewing. You guys probably didn't want me to get to remote viewing this way, but this is how I've gotten to remote viewing, is through the Aquinos. Because now we have officially, technically tied the Aquinos to the Church of Scientology, and I have a feeling that we're going to be tying them to the Process Church of the Final Judgment as well. But I didn't see this coming. Don't know who could have. Let me move this one picture over here, because a couple of these are kind of repetitive, but let me show you the one. I mean, she was very beautiful. She was a very beautiful woman, you know, can't knock her for it. But a demon? Yeah, kind of. That whole like Mikey and Shambi thing? Not with it. Not with it at all. However, here we go. So right here, beware goblins of human witches. I'm like, damn, okay, y'all are really coming at it. You know what I mean? Let me try and zoom in. There we go. So this is, yep, 1972. The Journal News. There she is. Obviously, very beautiful woman. So Lilith Sinclair is a priestess and grotto leader of the Church of Satan in Spotswood, New Jersey. She says Hollywood's hook nose and cauldron type is out, and she seems to prove it. Yeah, I bet she does. Now, where is it talking about the Ron Barrett? Right here. So if anybody knows, I know forensics has been working on it. I have had a couple people working on it. This Magician Occult Service Corporation, it's one of three New York City stores that cater to the occult. This is where she says that they get their incense, their robes, their altar garnishings. Ron Barrett, who is the president of the firm, can't really find anything about this guy at all. Now, what I have found is that he ends up taking over the Temple of Set, which is fascinating. That happens. And then I think he opens up, what, the Temple of Anubis or something after the fact. So I do think that that's interesting. But let me pop that back. Hold on. Let's go to the next one. And here we go. Here we go. The Psychic Phenomena Society of New Jersey. 1974 just seems to be a really busy year, doesn't it? Dang. And here we have Lilith, priestess of the Church of Satan. And Ingo Swan. Bada boom, bada bing. There it is. It's not them being in the exact same room. I don't give a damn. You guys know how the game goes, right? We all know how this goes. They don't have to be in the same room to make the argument, because I'm going to track them down now that I know. Because I've been avoiding the whole like remote viewing thing, because I don't really care. I don't care. However, Virginia's got all the tea about Ingo Swan, because Ingo Swan was a Scientologist. Right? So if we're doing weird remote viewing, Lilith is in New York. I actually have her in Staten Island, the same time as the process and the Children of God, which is really interesting, isn't it? So it just seems that all these things are coming together, and that's freaking beautiful. Hello, Lutefisk Glymates. Sinclair sounds false. So her real name is... ooh, I had it earlier. Patricia Wise, a.k.a. Lilith... Patricia Sinclair, a.k.a. Lilith Sinclair, a.k.a. Lilith Aquino. That's it. Yep. So her birth name is Patricia Wise, obviously. It's interesting because she talks about, you know, at that time, that was 1972, that she had a couple of children. Obviously, like, I wouldn't name her kids. But I don't ever remember hearing anything about Michael and Lilith having kids at all, you know, whatsoever. And thank you so much, Soil Lodge, to help with the process files you were trying to acquire. Thank you. That means a lot. I think that it's interesting. I don't know what happened to the kids. Did she like leave them with a baby daddy? I don't know. Who knows? I just thought it was interesting. I didn't know that she had kids. Now, let me show you guys this other one because this one's like so spoopy. I'm like, okay, I'm kind of here for it because you guys know that I love that goth stuff. But here we go. And they talk about the Satanic Brotherhood, which is kind of interesting. Seems like there's no lack of Satanic groups to join in on. So there she is, right there. Priestess of the Metropolitan Area Grotto of the Church of Satan and John DeHaven, High Priest and Head of the Church of the Satanic Brotherhood. And I don't really know what they're doing there in particular. And there he is. He's very serious. This is very serious. We're worshiping the devil. Worshiping the devil, right? And then there she is, being a spooky little hoe, right? So that's that. That's that. I didn't know that little Lilith was in New York. So I think that that's really crazy. But I am grateful that Leech sent that to me because guess what? We've got everybody, baby. We got the band back together. We've got Aquino. We've got Scientology. We've got the process. We've got everybody. We've got the Children of God. We've got everybody. Everybody. So this whole notion of like this cult being involved, and now, you know, we've talked about some of the Children of God stuff. We have a long way to go with that as far as IDing people, right? But I'm going to show you guys, they're on Staten Island, yeah? And we know when the process was, right? So we also know what ended up staying on the late Lieutenant Colonel Michael Aquino's army record. Right? They did take it off of Lilith's name, but they did not take it off of Michael's. So, one has to wonder, with the protection of his rank within the armed forces in particular, as well as this gentleman from the Church of Satan that I'm about to show you, who states that he was part of the Air Force, I believe, kind of like John Carr, right? It's just some food for thought, guys. Just some food for thought. Things to consider, especially for my New York people who are much more familiar with some of these places. So here we go. This is the Sunday News, February 27th, 1972. They do not give any of these people's names, which is very, very annoying, but... reminds me of the process, quite frankly. So this says, the first meeting of a black chapel set up to acquaint new members of the Church of Satan with proper rituals will be held Friday night in the Tompkinsville home of a warlock calling himself Garen Heer. For security reasons, neither his name or the exact location of the chapel can be made public, but he expects 8 people to attend. We are non-devil worshippers, and there will not be a black mass. However, I'm going to show you guys that this is not the case. So they talk about a compassion ritual, and that's lovely. But we also have lust or sex and destruction rituals. According to the founder, the destruction ritual is used for anger, disdain, annoyance, contempt, or hate. A ritual to wish them dead. Or at least break a leg. So at least they're getting a little bit closer to admitting it, in my opinion. Now, the five orders of Satanists, this gentleman that I was just referring to right here, Arioch, so he was a former British Army, hello, process, and U.S. Air Force veteran of the Far East. Okay, whatever you say. That's him. So in robes, I guess. I've got to try to hunt these people down because I literally just found all of this. But right here, it talks about the Lilith Grotto. And they met at a bookshop called the Wheel of Fortune. And up here, they hold rituals every 2 weeks in a small town in Jersey. And we do use a nude woman as our altar because we are a carnal religion. But we do not try to summon Satan since we believe in neither God nor Satan. Okay, sounds like a black mass to me, bro. But, you know, let's not split hairs. Because I'm going to show you guys. I didn't bring it up on Twitter, but I found Michael Aquino saying the most insane shit that I've ever heard in my life. The most insane shit. Like, seriously, excuse my language. But when I read it, I was just like, I called Virginia and I was like, Virginia, please tell me that I'm not crazy. She said, no, you're not crazy. It's very obvious. Thank you, Jandon. Stop it. Thank you, wood chipper technician here. And Mr. Alex, just wanting your opinion, Greaves, who is a member of the Committee for Skeptical Inquiry, which is known to have FMSF members as well. Is the skeptic community part of... Hell yes, part of the process. I just did a big interview on the Imagination podcast, specifically about Lucy and Greaves. Specifically. Because I don't need to know anything about him in particular. I'm well versed in the history of the institutions that he is involved in. But I did, you know, look up some stuff about him, listen to some of his commentary about things. She let me go off for a couple of hours. So I don't know if she's going to cut it or what, but it'll be coming out on the 25th. But I take him to task. And I do challenge him to a debate. Specifically about Michael Aquino. Because Mr. Greaves and his ilk love to talk about the Satanic Panic, and they love to leave out the late Lieutenant Colonel Michael Aquino. And I think that we all know why, if we're all being honest, right? So, we'll see. I have not had a man accept my challenge to a debate yet. And I don't expect that that will change now. Let me go ahead and show you guys Lilith talking at this psychical whatever where she's hanging out. You know, Ingo Swan, this remote viewing BS. Okay, well, then I'm not going to say anything, Jandon. I'm just not going to say anything. And yes, it's not Chris Graves. Chris Graves is my dear friend. This is Lucian Greaves. It's the dude. I'm not hating on his eye. I don't know what happened to his eye, okay? If he wasn't into the process, I would think that it looks kind of cool. I'm going to be honest with you. You know what I mean? I obviously, like, have things that I'm into, you know, whatever. But it's the... process. Ugh. Gag me with a pitchfork. Impale me with a pitchfork, quite frankly. So let's go ahead and take a look at Lilith. Following Satan, the natural thing to do. Okay. Whatever you say, Lilith. But this was at the Psychic Phenomena Society of New Jersey. And this is the thing that I love right over here. Members use the rituals and trappings of Satan to create a mood, and because man does need dogma and ceremony. But the objects are not worshipped. Her own outfit, she smiled, was worn because it makes me feel slinky, and because, let's face it, the public expects it. You ought to see me some Monday morning about 8:30 when I'm getting my two kids off to school. Okay. Whatever you say. This is me pretending to be normal. Okay, well, I don't buy it. Sorry, honey. And don't get me wrong, Lilith was a very beautiful woman. However, that don't cut it for me, shorty. Not gonna work. Now, I'm going to have to make this bigger. It's going to be really hard to pull up. I'm not reading this whole thing. There is one part of this, but I know some of you aren't on Twitter, so let me fix it. Because if you guys haven't seen a young Michael Aquino while he was still in high school, it would turn out that he might have not been lying about his eyebrows. I can't prove it, but his eyebrows might kind of go that way naturally, which is just stupid and kind of frustrating. But whatever, he literally looks the exact same. And then we're going to talk about his first wife, because I made some fascinating finds right before I came on. But let's go ahead. Sorry, it's the eyebrows. I always thought that he just styled them that way, and now I don't think that that's the case. I think that maybe he was born with weird eyebrows and he was just making them work for him. And I'm just like, damn it, you can't hate somebody if that's, you know, like, maybe she's bored with it, maybe he's bored with it. I think that maybe he was born with it. I'm dead serious. You guys can judge for yourselves. I don't know, but we're gonna start with the right, okay? So there we go. There he is. Look at his eyebrows. Look at his eyebrows. They're doing the bat wing. He's going to fly away. He's going to fly away to his bat cave. Look at me. I'm so spoopy. He didn't always have the widow's peak, obviously. But I mean, bro, that is him. That is him. Anyways, so right down here, hold on, because this is the most important sentence that I have ever heard him make. Okay, I don't know if you guys can see this. Hold on. Dang it. Okay, this paragraph that I'm pointing to right here, I'm going to try to make this as big as possible. Right here, Aquino boasts that his membership includes highly placed professional people both in the military, education, medical, and political fields in the U.S. and Britain. Okay, no big deal. He added, I would like to make it quite clear that the Temple of Set does not believe and would not become involved in any form of warm blood sacrifice. I'm going to repeat that statement. I would like to make it quite clear that the Temple of Set does not believe and would not become involved in any form of warm blood sacrifice. Our members would not carry out any sexual act for an immoral purpose. I would like to know, you know, what their morals are, quite frankly. But this very strange comment about warm blood sacrifice really seems like splitting hairs to me. And I've never seen him say that anywhere else before. And I think that that is really, really bizarre. I think that it's very concerning. And so I think that it makes some of the claims, quite frankly, I don't know. You know, Virginia has had posited something about, well, you know, the process was trying to do necromancy. I've shown you guys that. Are they working in collaboration? Maybe, because I'm thinking process. I'm process minded, right? But I'm thinking, because he didn't start Set until 75. He didn't leave and start the Temple of Set until 75. And he has placed himself technically with Lilith in 73. Now, he says he's in Kentucky. However, she's in New Jersey and she's in New York because she's running that grotto up there. There's a good argument to be made that he's probably up there as well. I do have him in Maryland a couple of different times, but it doesn't really give a lot of details in particular. But I am positing the theory in regards to warm blood sacrifices, obviously, you know, whatever, but also in regards to animals. Are they collaborating with animal shelters to dump carcasses? Are they splitting hairs about warm blood? Because that's weird. And I don't care if other people don't think it's weird. I think it's super weird, and I think that it is extremely suspicious. I don't like it whatsoever. I think that it's really gross. I don't know why, when he was being investigated, why that was not dug into a little bit more, quite frankly. I think that it's freaking insane. Now, I am going to pull up, because this was the thing that I was literally talking to forensics, and I said, forensics, my brain is short-circuiting, and so I have to show you this, and then I have to walk away from the computer. So, I was looking up Michael Aquino's first wife. Her name is Janet Forbes. As I'm looking her up, I find this crazy paper. It's very dark. It's very hard to see. It's from 1952. And this is Michael Aquino's very famous mother, as we all know, Betty Ford Aquino. And she is sculpting Michael Aquino's future wife's head. Why? I don't know. Let's get it weirder. They're in Provo, Utah. Let's make this even weirder. She graduates from Brigham Young University. She becomes a priestess in the Church of Satan while she's married to Dr. Michael Aquino. So, just some food for thought. The LDS has entered the chat in a second way outside of best friends. But here we go. So, right here. So that is his, that's the kid's head. I don't really see how that's life size. That head seems as big as his mother's head, unless she had a tiny head. I don't really know. But right down here, sculptress and her work, Betty Ford Aquino, San Francisco sculptress now visiting here, holds a piece of her own art, a life-size head she sculptured of Janet Forbes, small daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Fred F. Forbes of Provo. Yeah? Now, for those of you, I know there's a lot of rumors out there about the mom, right? And this does not say that this dude is Michael's dad. It does not say that this is Michael's father. Not the father. Somebody call Maury. Not the father. Not the father. And do the dance, right? However, this gives a great history about her. All the weird stuff that she's involved in. Because she is involved in weird stuff. She's an architect. KPFA radio. And they make a weird comment about it. Let me find it down here. Hold on. They said it somewhere else. What was it? Oh, yeah. They were getting funded by the Ford Foundation. The Pacifica Radio, whatever. And it says that the symphony ranges from simple folk songs for children to highbrow discussions of the courtship habits of spiders, astronomy, foreign trade, and travel recording. Okay. Okay. Whatever. It is what it is. This lady is super sus, but I think that it's very bizarre that Michael and his future wife, that's her head, that the mom is sculpting it. It's freaking weird. But then they get divorced. You know what I mean? So that's also weird to me too. I mean, I'm not judging people for getting divorced. I have obviously been divorced. It's not the end of the world. Let me show you, though, specifically, that way you guys can see it for yourself, and it's not me saying it, that this woman, who's a Mormon, who graduated from BYU, who his mom is making a sculpture of her head when they're little kids, that she ends up becoming a priestess in the Church of Satan. Right? Right there. So, 1972, I wish to take exception to Lana Ellis's rather impudent commentary concerning the filming of Studio One's The Satan Spectrum. My wife and I were present to observe the episodes in question, and it was our impression that all members of the cast and crew were rendered due courtesy and consideration by the producer and director. Miss Ellis's remark that we declared the hooded figure fainter to be possessed is absolutely ridiculous. In addition to being a satanic priestess, Janice holds a bachelor's degree as a registered nurse. Accordingly, she advised the necessary first aid for oxygen starvation. Sounds like they almost killed somebody, because I know what oxygen starvation means. Reverend Michael A. Aquino, the Church of Satan in Louisville. And For those that didn't know about the late Lieutenant Colonel, you know, an army expert on psychological warfare, he believes he is Satan's earthly lieutenant, the Prince of Darkness. And we're not going to be talking about Presidio right now because, quite frankly, I don't want to. I'm not in the mood. Not in the mood to talk about satanic Nazi pedophiles. But there's still people out there that simp for him. There's still people out there that, like, literally write books about that dude. Echo Cat, you gave me a super sticker or something. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. And let me see. Alex, they have not released the interview. It will be out on the 25th. I think that that is what Imagination said, but as soon as I have it, I will absolutely let you know. Hello, MDH1970. I'm sorry, guys. I feel like I'm so weird having sex with rocks. Who's having sex with rocks? That's gross. Who's doing that? Let me see. Charles K. Hello. Are there any signifiers for the documentary? What documentary are you guys looking for? I'm majorly catching up. Hello, JD Lotus. Hey, Jay Snyder. Does Aquino go on Oprah? Yes, he does. He absolutely goes on Oprah. But, like, the copy is so crappy. It sucks. The copy of him on Oprah is, like, the worst copy. I have yet to find a high-def copy. But it's an interesting interview because an audience member, the audience member sounds like they were a part of the process, straight up. The audience member that's, like, kind of panicking and freaking out and saying, like, we had to do a sacrifice, and Aquino gets super offended and he's like, we would never do that. And the guy's like, well, I had to do it. And Aquino basically sits there and mocks the guy. So I would be interested to find, like, a high quality copy of that interview. Cause that guy looks familiar to me. That guy looks familiar. He looks like one of the Processians straight up from that Son of Sam documentary, the Sons of Sam. One of the pictures where they're in the street proselytizing and he has aviator shades on. That guy looks identical to one of those dudes. Hello, Spy Gal. Hello, hello. And let me see. Janet Forbes. Wait, where did you go? Janet Forbes comes from a Mormon family and the connections run deep going a long way back. I just read the Spirit Cooking Woman has a line of skincare coming out. Ew, are you talking about... Oh, why can't I think of her name? Dang it. Marina Abramovic? Are you talking about her? She's coming out with skincare? Are you serious? Wow. I should just quit. That's crazy. Didn't they hire her to, like, start back up the school system in Ukraine? She was hanging out with John of God. Huh. Unreal. Unreal. People just don't care. That's completely nuts. Hey, Reb. Any tie-in with the SOS case this stream? Late to the stream. Well, I'm really just taking it easy, quite frankly. I'm not trying to, like, blow something up here as far as, like, information. I'm just trying to catch people up that aren't on Twitter. I'm showing some stuff that I found, some stuff that I didn't know. Now, I'm gonna pull this up because people had mentioned it in the comments, and I did have the marriage certificate of, this is Pauline Carr, this is Michael Samuel Carr II. This is his sister, so she gets married to this doctor on Honorato, right? But apparently these Honoratos are a very long lineage of people. So I'm just going to show you guys what I've found, because the later Honorato, which I guess would maybe be his nephew, I don't really know, because there's a lot of them. All of these people are doctors, which is really weird, right? But there's this obvious connection with the Catholics for Latin America. But the younger Honorato, I want to say Oronato, I feel like Domo Arigato, Mr. Roboto. I don't know why that keeps coming to my mind. But I'm going to show you guys, because whether it's his nephew or his son, I don't know. Let me see. It's his nephew. Okay, this is his nephew, but they're both in Yonkers. There's another one in Lafayette, Indiana. You know what else is in Lafayette, Indiana at that time? Dr. Alfred Kinsey. So I'm going to be looking into that. Who else was in Indiana at that time? Jim Jones. Jim Jones. Who else was in Indiana at that time? Dan Mitrione. Yeah, of Operation Condor. The butcher of Operation Condor. Yeah, there's a lot of really interesting places and names that this family is connected to. But I want to show you guys specifically for this Dr. Orinato and this Catholics for Latin America, because I don't have a ton. I'm just going to show you guys what I have, and maybe people have seen it before. However, you know, these people are supposed to be like rescuing kids from Latin America. They make it seem good, right? Obviously, I don't think that it's good at all, especially when like big churches are involved, right? However, they're talking about like children's sex education. Okay, that's disgusting. But I don't expect anything else from the Carr family, quite frankly. So let's go ahead and take a peek. So this is the nephew, Orinato, and this is his wife, right? And then this is them setting up a ticket committee for the Catholics. I'm going to screw this up. No, I'm not. There we go. Okay, so this is in 1965. So this is the nephew. However, these people are all related. You know what I mean? But like GOP sees film on sex ed, a film and slides on sex education recommended for children was shown by Dr. Robert R. Orinato. Okay, that's lovely. And then there's his wife in Yonkers linking up with all these other ladies for Catholics for Latin America, doing some, you know, committee, whatever, to get money. And there they are throwing a concert, right? That's great. And there he is, and there she is. This is obviously a very dark photo. I couldn't get it to be brighter. I'm sorry. But here they are, of sending laymen to help the poor in Latin America. Okay, whatever you say. Whatever you guys say seems really philanthropic, right? Sex education film set at Yonkers Church. I think it's really gross that this dude is an obstetrician and gynecologist and is doing this as well. But quite frankly, this seems to be his bag. This seems to be his bag, which is disgusting to me. I just don't think that these people should be allowed to be around children nor vulnerable populations, quite frankly. Because you know what this really reminds me of is the Levites out of Utah, right? So like I had done a really deep dive, like especially on Shalom Levit. She's a part of the Esalon Institute, but like, you know, they're over in Ukraine helping to establish democracy. But then you have Shalom Levit being funded by the Esalon Institute to teach kids about sex. And I'm just like, this isn't a red flag, right? This isn't a red flag whatsoever. Crimes like these need an elite team. Who do we call? Wood Chippers Worldwide. Worldwide. Reminds me of Step Brothers. Prestige Worldwide, except for it's Wood Chippers Worldwide. Because keep in mind, guys, in the context of the Children of God in particular, right? Because we've already proven that. We know where they are. However, in the context of the Children of God in particular, we know, and we'll get there eventually, but they were straight up trafficking kids out of Latin America. They were straight up trafficking children out of Latin America. Okay? So I think that the conspiracy about the Catholics for Latin America, because from what I understand from a forum that I found, someone who called me a child rape sympathizer, had made a connection such as this. And then their story kind of changed. And that's when the research changed. And I could be wrong on the timeline. I don't really care at this point anymore. However, I think that the Catholics for Latin America, when we line that up with the Children of God, and we line that up with the process, and we line that up with Dr. Carlton Gajusek, kind of seems like we have, we're ready to go. We've got it. We're ready to make the move, right? Because I said that I was going to do like a whole episode dedicated to Gajusek MA. Eric G was kind enough to send me some stuff about Gadjusek. Eric, I'm going to be completely honest with you, my friend. I have not looked at it yet. I have it saved. However, I'm going to show you guys what I found, and maybe you guys have seen it. And if you haven't, that's okay. It's fine. It is what it is. Like I said, I'm not here breaking new ground. And to some people, I wouldn't. I'm not breaking any ground at all. I'm 3 years behind, right? But I think that it is really wacky. I don't want to talk about the Willowbrook stuff with that little girl. I don't want to talk about it. I have it in the same PowerPoint. I don't want to talk about that Cropsey shit. Sorry, excuse my language. That Cropsey stuff makes me really mad because that Musket dude is like extremely suspicious. And the way that that Musket story is painted about him letting Andre Rand, which I found a fourth name for Rand, because Andre Rand went by like four names. And I found an additional name. But the way that the stuff with Andre Rand is painted with Musket, it makes me very, very angry. Maybe I will show you guys. Fuck it. Excuse my language. I'm whatever. Sue me. Okay. It's been a day. Sue me. Let me pull it up because I'll save the Jim Faulkner stuff for another day. Whatever. Let me pull this up about him because I had posted something about this. And from what I understand, people were told something different about Andre Rand. So, you know, determine for yourself. I don't know. I'm not the arbiter of truth, right? But right here. So they are talking about Van body found on Staten Island, but the skeleton is not the missing girl. So, in regards to Mr. Musket allowing Andre Rand to stay in his home, he was a convicted sex offender. Right here. He was always in that neighborhood. We're not talking about someone who's a dummy. He has a very high IQ. He reads a great deal. He told me he had studied criminal law at John Jay College in Manhattan. He knew more about the law than some of the cops who arrested him. And this piece of trash was arrested for abusing a 9-year-old girl previously. And he reportedly told hospital authorities that he wanted to talk to Musket after he was arrested. Yeah, I bet that he did. And right here, this Musket dude says that he believed that the ex-con knew the missing 12-year-old girl. He compared my son Chippy's speech with hers. Yeah. So I think that this is super disgusting. These people are complete trash. Let me see if I can just go to the next slide. So these are the photos that I could find of him. Now, these two photos of the church specifically, it's just maybe me being noited. However, both of those were just taken off of eBay. They were both taken off of eBay within 48 hours of each other, and there is no listing anymore. The listing is bye-bye. Bye-bye. So I just grabbed a little like screen grab, whatever. And then obviously a later photo of him because I think that the photos are important. Pictures are important. You know? Pictures are very important. Gotta bring it to life, guys. Gotta bring it all to life. Because this dude is gross. Seriously gross. Hold on. What did forensics say? Jim Faulkner was driving a VW Bug when he attacked someone in NYC and was fired. Maury didn't want me to contact the reporter who wrote about that incident. Oh, that's the guy. Didn't he like shoot at people? That's crazy. That's that dude. See, like, I get the names mixed up because there's just, like, so many names. But if that's the same guy I read about, like, yeah, he freaked out and he started shooting at people. And I was like, well, dang, like, what's up with this dude? But seems like some of these cops aren't the stand-up characters that Manny likes to paint them out to be, right? Which makes sense to me. But let me go ahead. I'll show you a little bit of Gadjusek. Whatever. Like I said, we're just kind of running through easy information, guys. I don't have a schedule. Let me see. Gurr, thanks forensics. But is, well, I'm fine, Dave Stege. I'm not doing a set schedule. I'm taking it easy. I'm just taking it easy. I'm not doing anything. That's why I described it as an easy Friday night. I'm not blowing anybody's minds. If I do, that's great, and I'm happy. Take the information. Do the screen grabs. Manny is wanting the board of directors of Untermeyer Park to give him a job in New Hedge Clippers. Yeah, I bet. Jim Faulkner was once a candidate for the Republican Party in Westchester County. Well, that's interesting. Didn't he buy property from... he bought the property from Wheat, right? It had to have been from Wheat, I think, from the timeline. Because wasn't it like a stupid small amount of money? Huh. You're right. He did. He did run. Yep. He sure did. Cop accused in hit and run that ended in gunplay. Yep. That's him. Yeah, see, I'm not going to take a pair of pennies from the peanut gallery that is Mr. Grossman or any of his friends, quite frankly. I think that you guys are, sorry, these newspapers are telling a different story. Don't care what people say when you go run into them in person, because they definitely have nothing to hide, right? Now, I'm not doing a deep dive on Gadjusek. I'll just show you guys what I found, because some people have literally never heard of Dr. Gadjusek. I had never heard of him. However, he is a very interesting person. He certainly made his mark in science, in medicine, and obviously in some other very dark ways, right? But I think that this is absolutely a valid element, and I'll show you why in relation to some of his properties that are literally right down the street from Wheat. Yeah? So it is what it is. But anyways, here we go. So let this pull up. There we go. Obviously, I wanted to make the first slide a little fun before it gets super depressing. But I hate it. Science studies mystery land free of disease. And that is him. Hate that. Hate all of that. No joke, but this laughter will kill him. Okay. Whatever you say. I think that was his brother. You guys know I try to go as far back as I can. I think that that was his brother. And that's him when he was very young. He was the state scholar in Yonkers. And then obviously for the brain disease, that is what he is most known for. Now, so he also studied cannibalism in New Guinea, a slow virus clue. You guys know I live for these old papers. But right here, so that guy is his success story. That is one of the kids that he brought up that had nothing bad to say. Jesus Ragamar. So he was 23, married a father and crown prince. Ragamar's journey from Faya Island reads like a recent novel. Now a junior at Hamilton, he literally was taken from his home in 1966 by Dr. Carlton Gadjusek. Literally. He asked me if I wanted to see America, and I said it would be great. Gadjusek worked out of the National Institute of Health in Washington, D.C. We try to enable kids like Jesus to go back to their homes and use the education they receive here to elevate their standard of living. Isn't that incredible? How many of those kids went home? That would be my question. How many of those kids went home? Seriously. Because this dude's disgusting, but you guys are going to see why. Now, I'm not going to sit here and pull all of this up. This guy was involved in the Boy Scout troops. He was working at Fort Detrick. He was also heavily involved in AIDS research, which is interesting, but I also think sad in a way. Let me show you guys the fire that is right around the car's homes, okay? That way you guys can see it, because then I'm going to show you guys the most colorful part of his work. So right here. So 1979, fire ruled arson, an apartment cellar in central Yonkers. So I made a little map because obviously I don't know Yonkers. I've never been there and I'm not going to be there anytime soon. You know what I mean? But I was like, well, that's interesting. So there was a building that was owned by Dr. Gadusek, and then he also had a home on Palmer Road in Yonkers. So that says 15 minutes, 3 miles from 316 Warburton Avenue. Whoop. Get that back up. Ah, sorry, guys. There we go. So from both properties, one is 2.1 miles from Warburton Avenue and the other one is 3 miles from Warburton Avenue. So there you go. Right there. Now, there he is. There he is. That's what you need to know. He's on NAMBLA. He's on NAMBLA. That was updated in 2009. And if you don't know what NAMBLA is, well, there you go. The North American Man-Boy Love Association. The Lie of Freedom versus the Truth of Family. What a hero, right? What a hero. You know what's real freaking crazy? They talk about Noam Chomsky in here. This is freaking ridiculous. Seriously, these people are completely disgusting. I can't. These people are gross. But I mean, look at the way that they write about them. In memoriam. You know what the memoriam should be? It should be, we took him outside, put him out to pasture, or in my opinion, put a giant stone around his neck and toss him into the ocean, and he doesn't get an obituary, so that no one ever has to be haunted with his face ever again. Ever again. Because that dude is completely disgusting. But I do think that it is really silly that that whole angle is completely played off as like it's irrelevant. I didn't know that that was the person that was being referred to as what is it, Moloch? Someone told me that like that's who Moloch is. And I was like, oh, I've heard of this Moloch. It's usually said Moloch has already been debunked. And I'm like, well, okay. If you say it's been debunked, then I'm assuming that it absolutely hasn't been debunked, quite frankly. Now, I only have a couple more things to show you. Sorry if I've disappointed you. I really had to catch people up, though, on the Twitter stuff because I'm way behind. So it is what it is. And quite frankly, I did want to come on and call Manny out for, you know, trying to paint me as a child rape sympathizer. Because I can't state that enough. You know, that's the kind of man that he is, whatever. Now, there was one guy that I wanted to show you guys, and I actually don't think it's in this one. But this is important, because this was someone that he said was, like, debunked. And I don't know what he means by debunked. Let me find it. This is the guy that gets shot on his boat, right? The guy that gets shot on the boat. I can't think of the freaking name. Hold on. I'm going to find him. We'll save the New Orleans stuff for another time. Sorry. I'm scatterbrained a bit. Where is it? Where's the boat man? Where's the boat man? I'm close. Because I've got so much stuff about Phoenix House. There's nurses getting murdered at Phoenix House. It's so much. I need help. Where is it? I'm going to find it. Bear with me for a moment. Talk amongst yourselves for 5 seconds. I'm close. Okay. We're almost there. Yeah, baby. There we go. 1, 2, 3. Got him. Okay. Got him. Bada boom, bada bing. I wish I had one of those sound buttons so I could do like the suspect noise. Okay. So I'm... never a disappointment. Well, I'm sorry. I feel like I'm wasting people's time if I'm not here like, bam, 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 because historical, mind-blowing, groundbreaking, blockbuster, whatever. Anyway, so let me show you guys really quick. Now, I'm not going to read a bunch from this. There's a couple things in this PowerPoint, though, in particular, because I didn't know these things. But apparently there was a massive murder for hire ring that was going on in 1974. And these rings were running through to the late 70s. Coincidentally, like right around the time that Berkowitz gets arrested, they actually hold a massive committee hearing. And it's really interesting. And you'll see why the picture in the newspaper was what made me look into it. Because I was like, who's thugged up with the ski mask sitting in this like Senate hearing? That's crazy. But I'm also going to show you guys the other reason why I decided to look into it as well. But me, why is this not showing the whole thing? Hold on. Let me get that fixed. Oh, it's because I have the little paper too big. Maybe it's time to take me out to pasture, guys. You know what I mean? Maybe I'm getting early onset dementia. Now, here we go. So here's the first one that I found. 1974. Is it gonna pop up? There we go. So cops link Newmark case to hire sleigh ring. So apparently this was a team of killers for hire. Started slaying. I think it says, yeah, one of the murders charged to the alleged ring is from August 11th, 1972. He was a wealthy businessman. He was the Republican and conservative candidate. Obviously, the FBI got involved because these were things that involved individuals within Massachusetts in particular. Now, I'm not saying that this is absolutely connected, but the fact that these things are going on, I don't think that that should be ignored. That's just my opinion. Now, let me move on. So, this is the one. I'm sorry. I'm going to show you guys that last slide, but look at this one. The fur around the face with the ski mask. I'm like, yo, thug life. Like, I'm here for it. I'm all about it, right? I think that it's fascinating. However, when I saw that, and I'm like, well, they're talking about a cop's mom getting killed. Like, what the hell is going on? But what they're talking about in particular is two victims testifying before a public hearing of the New York State Select Committee on Crime. Because there were crimes going on in particular against elderly people. But that's not all that was going on. Because when I looked this up specifically, what I ended up coming across was the hearing about the sexual abuse of children. And no, I am absolutely not going to sit here and read all of this. However, I am going to make this part a little bit bigger for the people that want to act like, dang it, like the snuff stuff is irrelevant. Because this is from 1977. And this is in New York. Intelligence information gathered by department investigators indicates that organized crime has gradually moved into the child pornography business. Possibly because of fear of public outrage, they operate through intermediaries, making it difficult directly to connect them with the sale and distribution of pornography involving children. The use of children in pornography seems to have been the special province of the child molesters turned photographers, who produced material either for their own personal gratification or for profit or both. However, given the enormous potential for profit and any lessening of vigorous enforcement, it can be predicted that organized crime will become more deeply involved in child pornography in the near future. When the heat is off, they move in. Our responsibility is to make sure that the heat is never taken off. There's a lot of dark shit in this hearing, but this is literally the same month that Berkowitz gets arrested. This is the same month that one might argue that the massive, it would be a conspiracy to cover this up, in my opinion, because I think that this stuff is valid. This stupid argument about listening to like a child rapist and that's the only person that's a source and blah, 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 blah. That's a lie. Manny thinks that you're stupid and that you haven't read the book. I hope that people understand that. Manny thinks that you're stupid and that you don't know how to read. Now, I am going to pull up Joseph Carrozza, okay? Because I was looking into Mr. Carrozza because his story sounded very interesting in regards to what happened to him. No, not saying that I solved the crime. Not at all. However, this whole debunking of this Carrozza in particular and what I was going to say Terry Maury, what he put in the book about what occurred when it was announced that this man was found dead, he did not lie. He did not lie. I have multiple papers of him not lying, the cops corroborating exactly what he said, and the cops telling the journalist, like, it's none of your business, because they're clearly covering something up. It's very obvious that they're covering something up. But let me go ahead and show you what I have for him, because I don't feel like I have everything, but I'm pretty sure that this crime is still unsolved. It's still unsolved. So at least Maury brought attention to this, quite frankly. You know, it's, I don't know. This whole thing is pissing me off. Anyways, so this is Mr. Joseph Carosa. I think that this is very interesting, and I will be looking into this. Him being a guest of the Israel Ministry of Tourism and LL Israel Airlines. Okay, whatever you say. Because it's 1975. What else do we have going on? Iran-Contra, right? We've got Iran-Contra stuff going on. So there's very likely some drug trafficking, maybe human trafficking, probably human trafficking, and weapons trafficking, obviously. And when I mentioned about these societies, these are the societies that I'm talking about, because we've got a lot of repetitive names in these holy name societies, these special societies, right? These are the good old boys of New York. That's what these are. So they call them the good old boys down here. But this is them good old boys. But these are the good old boys of New York. Crises don't deter tourists. Of course they don't. Especially if you're not, you know, if you're doing illegal stuff, right? The tense Cuban and French situations apparently have had little effect on summer vacation plans. Yeah, I bet. So here they're talking about going to Italy and France, whatever. So this dude is obviously plugged in. And here he is, part of the Department of Water Supply, Gas, and Electricity of the Holy Name Society. So he's the president. Imagine that, right? Now, over here, no trace of Slay Case Mystery Woman. Now, this is not the first newspaper, but this is the one that I have here, okay? You're going to see more. $10,000 reward. No clues. Oh, wait. I thought that Maury made everything up. Looks like these cops were doing fuck all, quite frankly. Excuse my language. But, again, good old boys? That can cross state lines. You know what I mean? Because they're going to protect their own. Straight up. But right here, let's pull this one up first, right here. So, does she hold the clue to the slaying? About 350 revelers at a New Year's Eve bash at a Westchester County country club will be questioned by New Rochelle detectives searching for the one partygoer who may provide a clue to the slaying of Joseph Carosa, a wealthy body and fender man who was shot dead aboard his 50-foot yacht. Police believe a woman may have been aboard the yacht about the time of the killing. A woman who lives in Miami and has been identified as Carosa's girlfriend is expected to be questioned. The Daily News reported Saturday that a woman attending one of several parties at the Lake Isle Country Club in East Chester screamed, "I knew they were going to get him," when word of Carosa's slaying spread through the club. Yeah? Okie dokie. I thought that Maury made everything up. Here we are, 1982. None of these are written by him. None of them. Still don't have a motive. They don't know who the woman is. Brother of the murder victim charged in a stolen car probe. Imagine that. Right here. Divers can't find the murder gun. Isn't that lovely? Isn't that lovely? Boat murder unsolved. They're stymied. Surprise, surprise. Murder probe leads to arrest for stolen truck with a false ID. Huh. Imagine that. Imagine that. Now, let me see what else I have on here. I make no promises. Oh yeah, so here's more. Woman may hold key to slang. Shaw dead aboard yacht. Seek clues in yacht slang. Is this the one where they tell the journalist to go away? Yep, here it is. So, this is, when asked who the woman was, New Rochelle detective Thomas Hughes replied, none of your business. None of your business. They brought a slim, dark-haired woman to his boat at 2:45 p.m., and later they carried away two plastic bags and a TV set. Wonder why they would carry away a TV set. Bueller? And this is where I got his name from. This is where I got the name from in the files. I don't see the child pederast rapist that Manny keeps trying to say that I'm carrying water for. But what do I know, right? I'm just a stupid hillbilly in the woods and a dumb woman. And I think for the moment, right now, that's really all I have. Sorry if that was disappointing. It is what it is. We had a lot to catch up on. Stuff with the Children of God. I'm working on the Way International. I have found some things. Nothing too exciting. I'm also going back and I'm cross-referencing names of the Wittervliet Knights of Columbus, right? Because don't think I forgot wheat. Because, you know, whatever. Somebody made a comment about, you know, your interview style previously. But I'm like, well, didn't she win the Oratory Award? And like, she was selected by the Knights of Columbus because I found the guy that chose the speech for her, right? And then she got, you know, everybody gets a little uncomfortable when we start talking about wheat. God forbid. Oh, no. So, I'm circling back. We got to talk about Montero. We got to talk a lot more about Phoenix House because I have a ton of other stuff about Phoenix House because, like I said, I've got that DA. I'm not going to pull it up now because it'll take me forever and my brain is fried. I've been researching all day. Anyways, that DA that they mention in that radio episode with Mae Brussel, she's not on it, but they credit her with the research. They talk about how that guy was tied to the OSS specifically before he became DA. And I literally have him inside of Phoenix House. I have him in the building. He's in the building. He's in Phoenix House. There's a lot of other really weird like rehab programs that are going on at the time. A lot of them. There's a lot of problematic stuff because next time I'm going to show you guys the deaths that occurred at Phoenix House. Some of the murders that occurred at Phoenix House. I'm going to try and fine tooth comb, look for Michael Carr. Because their vehement denial of Michael Carr working at Phoenix House makes me think that he was absolutely involved in Phoenix House in particular. But that's just my opinion. And again, I think that the stuff with John Carr's FOIA request this many decades later that we don't actually know the cause of death, it's actually not a sealed deal. And, you know, his family members know that as well. So it's not a sealed deal what happened to John. That might change the story a little bit. And people know that. But, you know, Manny's been playing these games on Twitter for like the past 48 hours. And it's, you know, it's fine. I'm not going to sit here and get all worked up about it. I could. Because again, Manny, I will clarify and I will end here. Because this is the last time that I am going to say anything about you. Okay. Because it's past trolling. It's very much so past trolling. You don't know what I've been through? You assume. Because you think that you're smarter than everybody else. You're not. You are running around now, painting me and others as a child rape sympathizer. And as a rapist sympathizer, and playing word games, and telling everybody that they're stupid. You are a joke. You are not a serious person. I have zero respect for you. And I am saying, in my personal opinion, and I am allowed to state it, because you have painted me in an incredibly ugly light, and you think that it's funny, but it's not. You are involved in a massive cover-up. I don't know what the cover-up entails. You constantly tell people that we have to accept the Carr family as heroes. I think that we should only be looking at the Carr family, quite frankly. And I think at one point maybe you knew that too. Some of the people that have been on your show, I have dug into, because obviously there's some interesting repetitive last names. So I have a feeling that there's maybe some historical, genealogical, familial, whatever, generational involvement in this. But you don't exist to me anymore. Because you play the game of, like, I'm in the rearview mirror. I'm enemy number one. I'm in the rearview mirror. You're going Zen mode. Wheat's going to sue me. Blah, 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 blah. I cannot respect or take seriously or give credence to or any more time to. And I don't want to hear it. I don't give a damn about your opinion. You seem so worried about my research, but yet so confident that there's nothing that I'm going to find. And that doesn't really make sense to me, unless there is something to find. Right? But you think that you're smarter than everyone else, and you're not. You're a cocky asshole who thinks that everyone should bend the knee to you. You feel that the world owes you something. You feel that the internet owes you something. And you feel like you are going to make it off of the work of someone who's dead. And you have mocked victims. And you have crossed the line with me. You are not a man. You are a child. You are disgusting. And you are not a serious person. I have zero respect for you. So please call me a troglodyte, call me whatever, make fun of me, I don't care, continue to ban my subscribers from your chat, continue to troll my Twitter if you wish. It hasn't worked out the way that you thought it was though, right? Because like you're not really good at Twitter, so that's unfortunate, but I'm glad that you've put into writing so other people can see how idiotic you are. Because you don't deserve the respect that I have given you up until this point. But again, I would maybe think about the things that come out of your mouth before you say things like that. You're an ugly person. You're an ugly-hearted person. And the way that you have talked to people, and I'm sorry that I'm getting emotional, but I have a lot going on, and I've been really sick the past couple of days, and I'm just trying to get the work done. You don't know what people have been through, Manny. And this is the last time that I am going to stress out over anything that you have fucking said. Because seriously, you are not a man. You are a child. You are a little boy who has earned fucking nothing. Trust me. You think that you have earned your place by mocking the dead and by mocking victims. You are a scumbag, and quite frankly, I look forward to seeing you fail because I believe in the truth. It's not about me being right. I believe in the truth, and I think that the truth will win. And I do not see you as an advocate for the truth. I see you as a hateful, spiteful person. So I look forward to your failure. And I do. Good luck.